in Iraq. We have 160,000 troops there, and we accuse them of meddling.
It's interesting you bring that up, because you have the Los Angeles Times that got leaked information from the military that stated 45% of the insurgency in Iraq is from Saudi Arabia, both financially and with manpower. Yet our response to that is giving Saudi Arabia a $20 billion weapons contract. You almost get the feeling that the countries that are probably adding to the destabilization effort in Iraq are not all being held accountable to the same as Iran. With respect to that, because you mentioned some words that really stood out for me, psychological propaganda and media, while I was listening to you talk in there. So really, after 9/11 and Axis of Evil, really, what is that all about as it relates to the everyday citizen, when you see that on TV?
I mean, what is it all about? It's all about the fact that we torture in this country now, and citizens accept it, that we eavesdrop on our phone calls, and citizens accept it. I mean, had you told the average American in 1999 that, you know, we're about to throw habeas corpus right out the window, and we're going to listen in your calls, and we can haul you off to Syria and rip out your toenails, they would have said, pure folly. This will never happen in America. And yet, we now tacitly, I mean, I know a large proportion of this country is against this, but the mere fact is we are doing it, and we haven't stopped the government from doing it. There hasn't been massive street protests. I mean, in the Senate, the Democrats now control Congress. They haven't stopped it either. And why? And that's because the country has been basically sufficiently scared into making these concessions. That, you know, people believe that in order for that, you know, for us to be kept safe, we have to give up some of these civil liberties. We have to sort of get into the gutter and in the swamp to fight back at the same level as our adversaries. And that's all propaganda nonsense.
Which goes completely against what our founding fathers taught us,
absolutely,
which is never give up civil liberties in the name of temporary security. And I'm curious, because I was looking at your last book, and you mentioned things like homeland security, and you mentioned things like RFID, you mentioned things like, you know, this could get to the level of where we're implanting humans with RFID in the name of security.
We're already implanting our soldiers.
Right.
Our special ops guys who can't afford, can't wear dog tags.
Right.
But they have these things on their right.
At what point do you think that the American people are going to have enough and are going to say, you know, that's it, we need to stop? And how can they prevent...
When's the next election? 17 months from now, hopefully?
But
I'm very partisan on this issue. But, all it takes is what I've always wondered is 3,000 people die. And this country sort of completely turned on its heel politically. What would have happened if in the space of a year 3 million people had died? I mean, what if an actual nuclear bomb had gone off in, say, Los Angeles or Manhattan, and then another one in Chicago? I mean, can you then imagine what kind of a country we'd be living in? So all it takes is something to go bang somewhere, and who knows how we're going to react. I think, you know, if there's any glimmer of hope, it's that the Democratic Party has sort of learned its lesson. That you don't just sit quietly by and be worried about, you know, seeming unpatriotic by criticizing. But, you know, during times of crisis when the stakes are higher, that is when you really need to keep an eye on government the most. And what happened after 9/11 is that the White House was given a blank check to do whatever it wanted. Hopefully, that if there was another terrorist strike, then much like the politicians did in 1957, was very interesting. Sputnik went up, and there was no national unity on the political level. The Democratic Party then, you know, took out the daggers and went after the White House, saying, hey, you promised to keep us safe. You're not keeping us safe. So hopefully, if there is, and I hope there is no terrorist strike, there won't be this kind of quiet acquiescence that there was last time. And the Democratic Party will come up and say, look, you got us into this mess in Iraq because you said that we're going to fight them over there rather than here. It's a complete failure. And if the Democrats don't do that, well, then, you know, we're likely to just continue going down the road we're going, and it'll just get progressively worse with every terrorist strike.
But this foreign policy, though, that with this nation-building foreign policy that we seem to be on, where we label countries actors of evil, like Syria, Iraq, Iran, North Korea, is that the right foreign policy, or is it time to change?
No, we don't have a foreign policy. We have it's like a bunch of six-year-olds that are dictating our foreign policy. I mean, it is an astonishingly immature foreign policy. It is either, nyan, we're not talking to you, or we call you names. There is no dialogue. You know, that we don't hold people accountable. That some of the worst offenders are our friends until they're not our friends. You know, take Uzbekistan, place there where I've been there, and Karimov, the thug president, he does some very terrible things. When we needed him, he was our best friend. Come over to the White House, can we put up a base there to use it for our, then we suddenly didn't need him, and now, you know, and now we're calling him a thug again. And I think, you know, that there has to be consequence to your actions, and you can't, I guess you can't live by double standards. That, you know, if there are friends, they can get away with murder. If they're not, they can't. And I think that's what the rest of the world sees that we don't see, is maybe the hypocrisy of this all. And I think we're slowly starting to, you know, to certain. I don't know if we see the hypocrisy, because, you know, that is a difficult thing for a nation to see itself so clearly.
Right.
But we're certainly, you know, as a nation, starting to see that. That, you know, that this clearly, this foreign policy is not working, and very encouragingly, we're starting to see many of the people, the professional bureaucrats, people in the State Department, people in the military. There's almost an open mutiny, where, you know, people see that, okay, there's light at the end of this tunnel, and I do not want to go down in history, you know, go down in flames with these guys, and that is why, you know, the only reason we are not in Iran today is because, you know, many people in the military leaking things to the press, and many people in the press and the politicians are starting to criticize and say, look, you know, no, we don't, you know, the intelligence that you're giving us, we don't believe it. The excuses you're giving us, you know, you've lost your credibility, and that's a hugely important thing, because if it wasn't for this public outcry that is kind of swelling up and getting stronger, not to repeat the same mistake we did with Iran, I think there's no question we'd be in Iran already. And I still fear we, before this administration is out of the White House, we will be in Iran.
I'm afraid of that too, to be honest with you. And I think that may very well happen right around the next election. What I do want to ask you, though, you know, you talk to very many prominent people, probably more than I do. You know, if you were to take a look at it, does Iran pose an imminent threat to the United States?
No. How?
That's easy to know. Yeah.
How? I mean, explain to me how. I mean,
I don't know of any missiles that could reach.
They do not
America.
Have the military capability. What they have is they have the capability to disrupt oil flows.
Right.
The only reason they would do that is if we strike them.
Right.
If we hit them and they, I don't know, blockade the Strait of Hormuz, you're looking at, you know, oil going to $200. What's it now? 60, what's oil now?
60, 80, between 60 to 80 bounces
right.
back and forth, but absolutely
going
all the oil companies.
Yeah. You know, $200 a barrel, you're looking at this country going into a massive recession. You're looking at the whole, you know, the whole global economy being destabilized. They actually have, yes, in that sense, you know, they clearly, you know, can become a danger, but that would be a danger, I believe, only in retaliation.
Right, not a nuclear danger.
Oh, no. They are not a military danger to this country, but economically they can wreak havoc
right.
on the entire planet.
What's interesting is that the current administration openly says they want to negotiate peacefully with them, yet our own president will not have a conversation with them. From a nuclear perspective, they're meeting the IEA requirements for the most part. I mean, they're pretty open to it. They belong to the non-proliferation treaty, and yet they're the only country in that region that does. Whereas Israel, India, Pakistan have not signed onto the NPT treaty.
Again, I think that's a double standard. That, you know, why?